physical properties are those characteristics that can be observed or measured without changing the composition of the material or what the material is made of. One example of a physical property is viscosity, which is how resistant that material is to flowing. So liquids that have a high viscosity are going to be thick liquids like honey or molasses or syrup, where liquids that have a low viscosity are going to be thin liquids like water or vinegar, for example. Viscosity is temperature dependent, which means that if I heat up a thick liquid or a liquid that has a high viscosity, then that's going to lower the viscosity of that liquid. So if I want honey to pour faster, all I have to do is warm it up. Another example of a physical property is color. Another example of a physical property is density, which we're going to use an equation to help us calculate that. So we're going to take the object's mass divided by its volume. The mass is typically going to be measured in grams, and the volume could either be measured in milliliters or centimeters cubed because those are equal volumes. I can use density to test how pure a substance is because each substance has a specific density. So silver is always 10.5 grams per centimeter cubed, for example, if it's pure silver. If I have two or more substances together, the one that's less dense is going to end up floating on top of the other one, and the one that's more dense will sink. The density of water is 1 gram per milliliter. So if I have a substance that has a density larger than one, then it will sink in water. If it has a density less than one, it will float in water. So to do some practice calculations then with this equation, if I am asked to calculate the density, then I must be given that object's mass and volume. All I have to do then is plug it in here. Mass divided by volume. That one's pretty simple. 5 divided by 2 gives me 2.5 grams per milliliter. But what about if they ask me for the mass? If they ask me for the mass of that object, they have to give me the density and the volume. So now I have to rearrange this equation to, instead of being density equals something, I need it to say mass equals something. So to figure that out, I first wrote down that original equation, D equals M over V, and I know I want to get mass by itself, so I circled it. If I multiply both sides by volume, then I have volume on the top and bottom here, and they cancel. And so all I had to do here was I just switched it, so now it says M equals D times V, or density times volume. Now I can plug in my values. Mass equals the density they gave me times the volume that they gave me, to give me a mass of 50 grams. The same is true for volume, so I need to rearrange this. So what I've done here is I rewrote the equation that I came up with here, right here, so M equals D times V. And I know I want to get volume by itself, so I need to divide by D on both sides, so I can get these D's to cancel or to equal 1. So I have volume equals mass divided by density. So now I can just plug in the numbers that they gave me. So I put the mass on top, which is 10, divided by the density, which is 2. So I get 5 centimeters cubed as my answer for the volume. More physical properties. We have odor and we have solubility as well. Solubility is the amount of a substance that will dissolve in a certain amount of solvent. So if my solvent is water, for example, and my solute is salt, I can't just keep adding salt to water forever and it will always dissolve. There comes a point where it won't dissolve anymore. So that point is basically what we call its solubility. So however much salt I can put in a certain amount of water and it will still dissolve would be that salt's solubility. Another physical property is conductivity, which is a material's ability to allow heat or electricity to flow through it. So objects that have a high conductivity are called conductors, and objects that have a low conductivity are called insulators. Objects that are good conductors are typically, or an example of them, are metals. Another physical property is malleability, which is the ability of a solid to be hammered without shattering. So an example of this is metals. I can hit on metal with a hammer, and it's not going to shatter into a million pieces. The opposite of a malleable material is called brittle. More physical properties. One of them is hardness, which is an object's resistance to scratching. So the harder a material is, the more likely it is to scratch something else. So if I have two materials and one scratches the other, the one that does the scratching is the harder material, and the one that is softer is going to be the material that ends up with a scratch on it. Diamond is one of the hardest materials that we have here on Earth. Another physical property is melting and boiling points. So the melting point is the temperature at which an object goes from being a solid to a liquid, and the boiling point is the temperature at which a liquid goes from, or sorry, the temperature at which a liquid becomes a gas. So for all of these physical properties, if I change one of those physical properties for a substance, I call that a physical change. So the properties or the characteristics might change, but the composition of that material is still the same. So I haven't changed what it's made of. So if I have a phase change, like I had up here with melting and boiling, if I have a phase change of solid water or ice becoming liquid water, it's still water, so the composition is still the same. If I scratch one of these materials like we were talking about with hardness, I haven't changed what that material is made of, so scratching an object would also be a physical change. Hammering an object, like we talked about for malleability, I'm changing its shape, but I'm not changing its composition or what it's made of. A lot of times physical changes are taught as they're always reversible, but that's not always the case. So physical changes are not always reversible. For example, if I cut a tomato into slices, I've changed its shape, it's still a tomato, but I'm not going to be able to get that tomato back in the same original shape that it was. Chemical changes do change the composition. So the substance is going to react with another to form a new substance that wasn't there before. So when I bake a cake, or anytime I burn something, or when the leaves are changing color in the fall, those are all chemical changes because I've created a new substance that's not there before. Now, sometimes it's hard to tell if you've made a new substance or not, so we have three pieces of evidence that we use to tell if a chemical change has happened. The first one is a color change, like the leaves changing color up here. Now, that's not always going to be the case. So if I have a glass of water and I add a couple of drops of red food coloring to it, yeah, that's a color change, but that's not going to be a chemical change because all I've done is just put two things together. That's a physical change. If I put two clear liquids together and they turn purple, that would be a good example of a color change. So you've had a chemical change happen because of that. Another one is the production of a gas, which we usually see by bubbling, which is called effervescence. So if I see bubbling, I know I've made a gas, and that gas wasn't there before, so that's a chemical change. Lastly, I have the formation of a precipitate. A precipitate is going to be a solid that forms when I put two liquids together. So if I put two liquids together and I get a solid, that's called a precipitate, and that is a new substance that wasn't there before, so that is a chemical change. Just as we had physical changes, we also have, just as we had physical properties, we have chemical properties as well. But for these, I'm not going to be able to observe or measure them without changing the composition. Since we know it's chemical, that means we do change the composition if we observe these properties. So characteristics that can produce a change in the composition, so a new substance or substances, will be formed. So one example of a chemical property is flammability, which is the ability of a material to burn in the presence of oxygen. Another one is an object or a material's reactivity, which is how readily it will combine chemically with other substances. So substances that have a high reactivity, that means they will combine easily with other types of matter. And if they have a low reactivity, then they will combine easily, or they will not combine easily with other types of matter. So specific elements are going to have high reactivity and low reactivity once we start talking about bonding.